Radio.
Oh my God, I'm a crazy man. Hi everybody, this is Daniel Gray. I am the Trailer Park Prophet coming at you live from beautiful downtown Crestone, Colorado on Blog Talk Radio. This is Hump Day with the Prophet. All right, let's get to it. What is it, March 5th now? We're already into the third month of the year. Thank God it's getting warm here. I'm getting ready for the summer. I'm sure you're thinking about summer and the spring and what's going to happen in the future. Of course, what we're talking about today is what's going on in Ukraine. We're going to talk about who's paying what on campaigns. We got a lot to talk about. I mean, there's a lot of back and forth between Putin and Obama over what's going on in the Ukraine. There's been talk about an Obama impeachment. In fact, I actually wanted to start with this story. And it deals with a hearing that was held today at the U.S. Capitol. It was held by the House Government Oversight Committee that is chaired by Daryl Issa. And his committee is charged with oversight of all and any of the government agencies that are out there. And Daryl Issa, his committee has been looking into what happened with the IRS in regards to their harassment and over-scrutiny of the Tea Party, Christian organizations, Jewish organizations, any organization that had liberty in their name or freedom or patriot. They were unfairly scrutinized by the IRS. And what I'm saying is that what happened with the IRS and the Tea Party is a much larger scandal than the infamous Watergate scandal during the Reagan administration. And just to refresh your memory, the Watergate scandal was about some hired thugs. They were actually hired by some mid-range, mid-level Republican political operatives to go into the Watergate Hotel and break into the National Democratic headquarters and try and find whatever information they could find that would give the Republicans some insight into whatever election cycle they were in during the Nixon administration. And I can't remember all the particulars. I think it did probably go back. It did make some connection into the White House. There were several White House advisors that were implicated and eventually had to appear before various congressional committees, like what I mentioned here with Daryl Issa and the IRS. And eventually there was information that this scandal, this break-in scandal of just several thugs, mind you, made their way into the Watergate office of the Democratic Party. And it did eventually lead in the impeachment of President Nixon, and actually before the he was officially impeached, I believe he stepped down. And there were several in his administration that were, like I said, were indicted and prosecuted and actually did spend some time behind bars and were totally discredited. And it was probably the biggest scandal in the history of modern politics, or at least the 20th century, because it actually brought down a president. I mean, it's happened before, but in recent memory, Nixon would be the one most remembered as far as a president who had a scandal that brought down his administration. But you compare and contrast what happened to Nixon and what is going on here with the Obama administration and the IRS. I think you're comparing drastically different sizes of scandal. And I'm saying that the Obama scandal was a much bigger scandal in its depth, breadth, and scope than what happened in the Watergate break-in. I mean, this deal with the IRS. Now, today, the head of the IRS, who was the head of the actual department that handled the 501Cs, that's the nonprofit part of IRS, her name is Lois Lerner. She was before the Oversight Committee today, and she was the one that was directly responsible, like I said, for scrutinizing all these applications from the Tea Party and from conservative groups and liberal groups, progressive groups, and scrutinizing their operation and allowing them to be awarded by the IRS the nonprofit status. And that's important because then you can collect funds as long as you don't act in a political manner. You can collect those funds. You don't get taxed on that money. And the people that donate that money to you, they actually have a credit against future taxes, or they have a deduction or something like that. And it's in my mind, I know this is an aside, but again, 501Cs, nonprofit status is a sham, and we should do away with all of it. I mean, every organization, I don't care if it's the American Red Cross or the Sisters for Retarded Crippled Children, they should all pay tax on the income they get. And the people that, or at least the people that give money to all these 501Cs should not get a tax deduction. I mean, I would do away with them completely. Everyone should pay their fair share as far as I'm concerned. But anyways, I digress. So anyway, Lois Lerner, this last summer, I'm trying to think, actually no, it would have been in September of last year, Lois Lerner, head of the IRS 501C department in the IRS, went before ICE's committee, Daryl ICE's committee, the House Oversight Committee, and invoked her Fifth Amendment rights, which are guaranteed in the Constitution that you can... you don't have to testify against yourself. You can take the Fifth Amendment, which is a guarantee that you don't have to self-incriminate yourself. You know, it's one of the many Bill of Rights that are afforded to us as Americans. And so this government employee took the Fifth in September. And then she's before the committee today, and she actually did the same thing. She took the Fifth again. And you don't take the Fifth if you don't have something to hide. And we reported, I believe 2 weeks ago, that Lois Lerner was looking for immunity from prosecution from the committee. And this committee may have to give her that immunity. Give Lois Lerner immunity from prosecution for her not to invoke her Fifth Amendment rights. That's the only way that she said yesterday that she was going to testify. So obviously that deal hasn't been worked out yet. But there was another article yesterday I was reading that said that Lois Lerner was in fear of her life. Now that could be a bogus story, could be a plant, or it could be the truth. Because if Lois Lerner comes out and testifies and tells what she knows, you know that what she was involved in was most likely a felony. I mean, she knows what she was doing was against the law. I mean, they went around a lot of people. They fast-tracked some of these Tea Party applications so that they could get hung up in an attorney's office, so that what they were doing was refusing the 501c nonprofit status to these conservative groups by not dealing with their application, or they would go and go to these people's houses and they would make all kinds of requests for unreasonable information, like who do you pray to, who are your friends on Facebook, a bunch of inappropriate things. And then not only that, all these other agencies of the United States government were given lists of people who were applying for these 501c status. And so the whole weight and force of the government was hoisted upon these conservative groups. I mean, literally the IRS gave information to the Federal Election Commission, the FCC, OSHA, the EPA, and any number of other groups. They literally gave them the names of these Tea Party groups, and basically the understanding was that they should go and harass these people, because there's numerous accounts of people who, after they applied for a 501c for a conservative group, were inundated with the alphabet soup of federal agencies who came out of nowhere and have never been in these people's lives before, and now all of a sudden they're getting multiple visits from multiple agencies of the federal government. I mean, this is exactly how the Gestapo works. You know, this is a really bad situation, and I think most people now are so desensitized or so ignorant or so unaware, they can't actually look at what happened here with the IRS and understand in their heart of hearts that this is the kind of thing that goes on in Stalinist Russia or happened in Hitler's Germany. But this is the type of thing that America was not intended to have happen. I mean, this is a government that's run amok. And it involved several high-level Obama administration figures. In fact, we know from emails that the actual conversation of targeting conservative groups, Tea Party groups, went all the way into the chief counsel for the president's office. We can prove that by emails, or other people have proved that by emails. So that's as good of a connection as the Watergate investigators had back during the Nixon administration. I mean, they were only able to connect it into the White House. I'm trying to think what those guys did. I don't think there were any cabinet members. I believe that the ones that went to jail were advisors to the president. But regardless, they were obviously in the White House, a few of them, three of them, or whatever it was. But this, we know now that this scandal, this IRS scandal, went all the way to the White House through their chief counsel, the president's chief counsel. But this is a much bigger deal, because Watergate was just a stupid idea spawned by some mid-level political operatives, and they went out and hired some second-rate hoodlums, thugs, to go break into the office. And, you know, really, if you know much about politics, there wouldn't be much even to steal. I mean, you know what the Democratic strategy is going to be because you watch TV or you look in the paper. I can't imagine what these numbskulls thought they might find in this office. I mean, it was such a silly thing to do. Really, but this thing with the IRS, I mean, this is collusion, all right? This is This is conspiracy. All right, there's numerous laws that were broken. I mean, there used to be all of these fail-safe steps that any kind of application would have to go through. I mean, all the procedure was bypassed. I mean, they broke their own rules. They broke the rules of the United States and Congress on privacy, sharing information. I mean, the IRS isn't supposed to share any information with any other agency. And there's proof that there was a lot of sharing of information from across the board of all these other government agencies. So there was collusion, you know, there was conspiracy, really, to commit government harassment. I know there's statutes out there that prohibit the government being a predator on its own citizens because of ideology. I mean, this is the worst possible thing, the worst fear of any student of government to ever imagine, that a government using its own resources to target a particular ideology or viewpoint. I mean, that's a total breakdown of what we expect from our government. We expect our government to be impartial. And because of the nature of this offense, that there were so many people involved, I mean, there was hundreds of IRS agents involved. I mean, there were, I can't think of all the names right now, but there were, I mean, even the inspector general. Every agency has an inspector general that's supposed to be like an arm's length, disaffected third party observer of every single government agency. That individual admitted that there was wrongdoing in the IRS in regards to their scrutinization of conservative and Tea Party groups. So, that in case you're new to this subject, this isn't something that is haphazardly investigated. There's a lot of people on this story, not just Congress, not just Republicans, but a lot of people. Like here, this article here is from the Daily Caller. And early this morning, like I said, Daryl Issa angrily adjourns oversight hearing after Lois Lerner pleads the fifth for the second time. And we'll go down here a little more. It says, California Rep. Daryl Issa adjourned a divisive House oversight hearing Wednesday after IRS official Lois Lerner pleaded the fifth and refused to answer his questions. Seeking the truth is the obligation of this committee, Issa said before announcing that he had no expectation that Lerner would answer any questions and adjourning the hearing. Lerner invoked the Fifth Amendment on each question Issa asked about the agency's targeting of conservative groups. The hearing lasted approximately 15 minutes before Issa released Lerner. And so what you got to do is read between the lines here. Now, part of what ISA is doing, there is a process that he's following. And he wanted to give her most likely another chance, or he wanted to demonstrate again for the public and the press that, look, this woman's pleading the fifth. That means she has culpability. That means she's guilty. That means that there's something here that she can't cover up and probably will come out eventually anyway. Otherwise, she'd try to play a little more cat and mouse for a while. So, I mean, part of this is kabuki theater, you know, kind of check the box. Okay, we gave you a second opportunity and you again invoked your constitutional right against self-persecution. So Issa began the hearing by explaining that Lerner previously waived her Fifth Amendment right in May, I guess it was May 2013 hearing, and that the committee may proceed to consider whatever she may be in contempt. Issa did not choose to hold old Lerner in contempt of Congress on the floor of the hearing. It is unclear at this time if he will choose to pursue contempt charges. Immediately after Issa adjourned, Democratic Oversight Committee ranking member Representative Elijah Juan Cummings angrily blasted Issa's efforts. Issa ignored Cummings and shut off the Democrat microphone. You can see him doing that right there. But what Issa was talking about is that what Learned did on May 2003 was she basically first said an opening statement before she claimed her Fifth Amendment rights. She gave a statement which said that I didn't do anything wrong, I didn't do anything illegal, blah, 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 and then she invoked her Fifth Amendment right. And so that's what Issa was alluding to, is that she waived her Fifth Amendment right after she gave her explanation and then took the Fifth. I know it's kind of a nuance, but it's important. You should understand this stuff. All right, we got 3 minutes here of the committee hearing this morning, and let's give this a listen. Again, Daryl Issa is the chairman, Republican chairman from California, and Lois Lerner is going to be the woman who's going to be, she's going to be executing her Fifth Amendment rights, invoking her Fifth Amendment rights. All right, here you go. Take it away.
In order to testify.
On the advice of my counsel, I respectfully exercise my Fifth Amendment right and decline to answer that question.
All right. Now he's thinking, now they know. See, now they know in this minute, this is why it's taking some time, that she is going to plead the Fifth.
Seeking the truth is the obligation of this committee. I can see no point in going further. I have no expectation that Ms. Lerner will cooperate with this committee, and therefore, Chairman, I have a statement. I have a procedural question, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I have a procedural question. Mr. Chairman, you cannot run a committee like this. You just cannot do this. This is, we're better than that as a country. We're better than that as a committee. I have asked for a few minutes to ask. What's the big deal?
So he turned off his microphone. Daryl Issa turned off Congressman Cummings' microphone.
Thank you very much. Mr. Chairman, I have one procedural question. And it goes to trying to help you get the information, by the way, that you just asked. What is your...
One thing to tell you, too, a procedural question is always in order. Not always can a congressman or senator interrupt during the proceeding of a committee or on the floor. But a question of procedure is always in order. Congressman Cummings. Shoot. Well, I stopped the video and then I'll continue.
No, let me say what I have to say. I've listened to you for the last 15 or 20 minutes. Let me say what I have to say. Chairman, I have one procedural question. Ms. Lerner, your release you made. But first, I would like to use my time to make some brief points. For the past year, the central Republican accusation in this investigation, we're adjourned, close it down. Before our... Thank you.
So, anyways, that's not really good radio. He continues to holler and... See, he's out of order now.
A one-sided investigation. There is absolutely something wrong with that, and the
And that's fully within the chairman's right. And now the chairman's getting up. So now the chairman's leaving. So yeah, man, I guess that's it. At any rate, that was an ugly scene. And Congressman Cummings was way out of bounds. He didn't have a question on procedure. He wanted to make a statement. It was inappropriate at that point in time to make that statement. So Congressman Cummings was way out of line. He was out of order. I think I got something else here. We'll leave this story alone. Wait. Here we go. Okay, here she is again. Here's Lois Lerner on video today. I think my hope is there's a little more here.
We are primed to bring back more of the good jobs claimed by the recession, but that requires a year of action.
Now's his chance. The Keystone XL pipeline is ready to be built. It's all up to the president. Will he say yes to new jobs? Yes to economic growth? The choice is his. The opportunity is ours. Mr. President, take action.
All right, here we go. Chicago Tribune.
The committee is recalling a former Internal Revenue Service official who refused to answer questions about the agency's Tea Party controversy at a hearing last spring. Lois Lerner headed the IRS division that improperly targeted Tea Party and other conservative groups for extra scrutiny when they apply for tax-exempt status. House Oversight Committee Chairman Daryl Issa said Sunday he expected Lerner to testify at Wednesday's hearing, but a committee spokeswoman said Tuesday she could only confirm that Lerner was expected to attend the hearing.
So what we just saw was, I nailed it. It was a showdown. The committee didn't know.
We are primed to bring back more of the good jobs claimed by the...
The committee didn't know whether or not Lois Lerner was going to testify. She probably gave them the idea that she was or that she might. So a lot of gamesmanship going on behind the scenes that we're not privy to. All right, let's move on. You're listening to Daniel Gray. I'm the Trailer Park Prophet, broadcasting live on Blog Talk Radio from beautiful downtown Crestone, Colorado, where we are under sunny skies. I was out for a 3-4 hour walk with Bailey Barker this morning, and spring has sprung in Crestone. It's absolutely beautiful. I'm so grateful to be here. I hope everything's going okay for you. I got this from Hawaii Bob, or Hawaii Rob, you know, one of these little postings on Facebook. It says, come to Chicago for the food. Stay because you got murdered. Because I think Chicago now has the highest murder rate per capita than any other city. Or, you know, at least they're in the top five. Which, again, it's worth mentioning that in the cities where they have the most gun control laws, they have the worst violent crime. An armed public is a safe public. And here's kind of an interesting, here's Nancy Pelosi. Nancy Pelosi, you'll remember, was the Speaker of the House. She's a Democrat from San Francisco. She was talking about how the Congress needed to pass Obamacare before people had a right to read it or had time to read it. And she said, we have to pass the bill so you can find out what is in it. Nancy Pelosi, meaning Obamacare. And remember, too, President Obama, not only did he promise that all of the health care debate would be on C-SPAN, which didn't happen. All the Obamacare debate was done behind closed doors. on special orders, so no one knew it was going on. And no one had read Obamacare from the House or the Senate before they were asked to vote on it. And also, President Obama promised, remember, he promised that any bill he signed would have to be on the internet for 72 hours so people had a chance to read it. And he violated that law. He signed the bills earlier. And really, there ought to be a comment period for any bill that's passed through our United States Congress. I mean, there ought to be like at least 5 days, if not 30 days. There ought to be 30 days after a bill is passed so that people can have an opportunity to weigh in so that they can maybe start to initiate their effort to address their government, petition their government to block a piece of legislation. But the Obama team, they won't even let people have an opportunity to read the bill before he signed it, like he promised. I mean, that's evil, intellectually dishonest. All right, so in contrast to Nancy Pelosi, James Madison said, "It will be of little avail to the people if the laws be so big that they cannot be read, or so incoherent that they cannot be understood." And Obamacare was both. It was over 2,000 pages. Even if it was over 1,000, that's too big. It didn't need to be that complicated. And it was incoherent because if you read Obamacare, in one paragraph, there'll be 5 or 6 citings to other publications or other laws or other rules and regulations. So it's impossible to read. You know, read one paragraph and then you got to go dig up 5 other sources. That's incoherent. And that's exactly what James Madison was talking about over 200 years ago. People like Nancy Pelosi saying we have to pass a bill so you can find out what's in it. I mean, it's kind of chilling in a way just how much James Madison understood. And I guess the bigger point is when James Madison and the rest of our founding fathers wrote this Constitution, they understood that there were people like Nancy Pelosi. They understood. I mean, remember, they knew back in Roman times. We had another quote from some politician or whoever from over 2,000 years ago that said the same thing, that once the government starts passing laws that the people can't read because they're too big or too incoherent, then that's the decline of that civilization. This is kind of cool. Thank you, Florida, Kentucky, and Missouri, which are the first states that require drug testing when applying for welfare. Some people are crying and calling this unconstitutional. How is this unconstitutional? It's okay to drug test people who work for the money, but not for those who don't. Repost this if you like to see this done in all 50 states. If you can afford to buy drugs and extra illegal things, then you can afford to buy your own groceries. Do you agree with that? Oh, this is kind of funny. It's 3 pictures of President Obama, one of them at a White Sox game in Chicago, throwing in the first pitch. And I mean, he totally looks like a girl or a sissy. Obviously, he hasn't thrown very many hard balls. And then the other picture, he's standing with Michelle and he's doing one of these, ew! Like he saw a spider or mouse or something. He looks like a total sissy. And then the other famous picture where he's riding the girl's mountain bike with the helmet on. In the caption, real low blow, says, "This is Women's History Month, celebrating our first girl president." And I decided to do this because I wanted to recognize March as Women's History Month, and I want to spend some time with some of the many accomplishments of women in the history of the United States and, of course, the whole world. Okay, this is kind of interesting. I think this story actually came from the New York Times. And this was Out Today, story written by Mark Mazzaretti, Washington, the Central Intelligence Agency attempted to keep secret the details of a defunct detention and interrogation program has escalated a battle between the agency and the members of Congress and led to an investigation by the CIA internal watchdog into the conduct of agency employees. The agency's inspector general, and remember that's the person, like I said earlier, is charged with oversight of their particular agency. Independent, hopefully. Anyways, the CIA's agency inspector general began the inquiry partly as a response to complaints from members of Congress that the CIA employees were improperly monitoring the work of staff members of the Senate Intelligence Committee. According to the government officials with knowledge of the investigation, the committee has spent several years working on volumes report about the detention and interrogation program, and according to the official interviewed in recent days, CIA officers went as far as gaining access to computer networks used by the committee to carry out its investigation. So you have an investigation of the investigators. And you think we don't have too much government? This is a perfect example. I mean, I understand the importance of, like, the chain of information, the chain of evidence. I guess you could look at it like that. I mean, the CIA is out there collecting information, and they're giving it to members of Congress and their staff under the agreement that it's secret, that none of this information leaves the room. And if it's leaking out, I can see how the CIA would want to find out who's doing that. This is interesting. It says the specifics of the Inspector General's investigation are unclear, but several officials interviewed in recent days, all of whom insisted on anonymity, citing a continuing inquiry, said it began after the CIA took the senator Mark Udall, Democrat of Colorado, on Tuesday called an unprecedented action against the committee. The action, which Udall did not describe, took place after CIA officials came to suspect that congressional staff members had gained unauthorized access to agency documents during the course of the Intelligence Committee's years-long investigation into the detention and interrogation program. Now, let's see. Found. And, of course, the Justice Department declined to comment. But really, we're not finding out what we want to find out, and that is we want to find out more information about the interrogation and the confinement. That's what we want to find out about. I mean, where are these places? How many people have been, you know, detained and incarcerated, you know, without their habeas corpus rights, their right to be told what they're being accused of, their right to call somebody, their, you know, right to have competent counsel. So, you know, you got to, here we go. You know, here's what we have to do here. We have to read between the lines. And that is what we're learning out of this article, is that the CIA does, in fact, most likely have a clandestine detention and interrogation operation, and it very well may be in the United States. All right. And the way we know that, okay, now we got to read between the lines. The way we know that is because of Udall's office actually allegedly tapping into the CIA's computers. I mean, talk about cloak and dagger, my fellow lovers of liberty. I mean, these guys have way too much time on their hands. Let's see, what else do we have here? Listen to this. It says, in a statement last year, Mr. Brennan, he's the head of the CIA, said that the interrogation methods once used by the CIA are not an appropriate method to obtain intelligence, and that their use impairs our ability to play a leadership role. So he's just going back and restating whatever their narrative was back during the Bush administration. Let's see, importance is the community view, because on cables. And so really, you know, another one of these stories where the headline doesn't tell the whole story, but I think now we have a better idea. I mean, is anyone out there surprised that the CIA is illegally detaining people and questioning them? I mean... Oh, here, this is, I think we can do this. I think this might be good. This is something I wanted to talk about. There's actually a few other, I want to do something else during the program. I want to talk about what's going on in the Ukraine. I got a really good article I want to read to you, and I think it's going to blow your mind on a lot of very various levels. But I want you to listen first to this guy. His name is Ron Rejcik. And he wrote a book that is getting a lot of attention. It's called Disinformation. And this guy is a defector from the Soviet Union. In fact, he is the highest ranking defector from the Soviet Union that we've ever had. And he wrote this book, Disinformation, about a secret strategy. And he talks about what he learned while he was in the Russian CIA. I think he would, yeah, he was a CIA, not a CIA agent. He was with a KGB agent in the former Soviet Union. And he wrote this book, and he was on Glenn Beck. I'm not sure exactly where this recording's from, but here recently he was on Glenn Beck, and he blew my mind. And I think you'll agree with me that this guy, I want to try and say his name again, Ron Rejcik, is the reason I like how this guy, just listen to him, because he's able to construct construct a picture or an understanding of what's going on right now in our body politic across the world in a way that I could understand it, and I know you can understand it. But it's good, I think, sometimes to learn to sort of rewire our brains so that we're able to more objectively look at the world around us. And I think this guy knows how to do that, and he's talking about something that is something we've talked a lot about on this program, and that is that there's a lot of psychological warfare going on in our society, and most of it's coming from the progressive socialist status. You know, we've talked about Edward Bernays, who was the godfather of propaganda, who was Sigmund Freud's nephew. You know, it's no mistake that all these people have progressive socialist statist connections. And that's the part of the puzzle, or the you know, the actual lay of the map that people don't quite understand, that this has been going on a long time. This has been going on since the 17th century. All right, so let's give this a listen. Take it away, Mr. Ron Rachick-Black.
Sense and explain stuff. And so I wrote this chapter for the second edition of Hitler, the War and the Pope, chapter 16. And then I decided to send it to Pachepa, the guy who had written the article, the National Review Online. And I didn't know how to get in touch with him because...
Oh, shit. All right.
Well, for reasons that are obvious or will be in a moment, they got it to him. They sent him my chapter, and he got in touch with me. And we have had a great email relationship primarily since then, although we have met in person. The Chapa's a fascinating man. The Chapa was the number two guy under Ceausescu in Romania. He was the head of what was called the DIA, the DIA. I feel like it's a Get Smarts thing sometimes. It was the equivalent of the CIA, more or less, foreign intelligence in Romania during communist times under Ceausescu. He had been a bright young man, bright boy, did well in school, got drafted into this area. His father had always talked about America. He'd always wanted to come to America. But that dream, you know, of becoming American never happened. Pachepa decided to... he came ahead, and he realized that he was pretty good at what he was doing. And he really realized how good he was one day at the White House. I mean, he lived a life of luxury, by the way. I mean, he hung out with Khrushchev and Castro and Carter and world leaders. Really, he was one of the privileged few in one of these communist societies. And this day with Ceausescu and Jimmy Carter in the Rose Garden, Jimmy Carter and Pachepa was not in the picture, but Pachepa was there. Pachepa hears Jimmy Carter say, "This new man, this Ceausescu, this new communist, this new man from Romania, this great leader, a guy we can do business with, a new opening between our nations." Pachepa hears this. Pachepa knows Ceausescu's a butcher, committing genocide against his people. He said, "I can't believe we fooled the leader of the United States this badly." But they had. And that was part of Pachepa's job, to fool the West, and indeed he had done so. Pachepa had made his mind up that if the time ever came where he was asked to be involved in an assassination, he would defect. And that happened about 3 months after the incident in the Rose Garden. Pachepa was asked to kill somebody. He went back to his home. He'd been playing violin since he was 7 years old. He went to his mother's portrait. Played a song to his mother's portrait. Mother passed away. Laid down the violin, has not touched it since. Went to the American embassy and got flown to Washington. When he came to Washington, by the way, Jimmy Carter didn't believe him. Jimmy Carter wanted to send him back to Romania, which would have been a death sentence. Absolutely. So, fortunately, the CIA folks who were involved in the debriefing process. Did believe him, talked Jimmy Carter out of sending him back, but he was being debriefed for 3 years. And during these 3 years, you know, he told all kinds of stuff that eventually became the book Red Horizons, which was published in, I want to say, 1987. During this time, when Pachepa left, Ceausescu, first of all, is outraged. He puts first a $1 million bounty on Pachepa's head, then adds a second $1 million bounty. He dispatches Carlos the Jackal, an assassin, to go after Pachepa. Pachepa becomes aware of this. So today he lives under an assumed name, a new name, and which I don't know. I don't know where he lives or what name he lives under. The joke is, I know Superman, I don't know Clark Kent. And I told him that one day. I said, "I know Superman, I don't know Clark Kent." And he said, "What are you talking about?" So I'm milquetoast. I'm involved in my church and very little else. In fact, one day one of his neighbors went up to him and said, you know, you need to be more involved in the world. You know what's going on? Read this book. He gave him a copy of Red Horizons. Which, I mean, if you can imagine that, that's pretty funny. But Pachepa eventually wrote this book, which President Reagan called his Bible for dealing with dictators. If you know Pachepa, you will hear about disinformation. Pachepa says disinformation is, you want something that comes from a trusted source, which has a nugget of truth and cannot be disproven, so you have no original documents about it. So a play, a fictional play, which we trust artists, there's a nugget of truth, and Pius XII did not repeatedly use the bully pulpit, and there were no original documents involved. There are stories like that. If you think about during the war, during Vietnam, for instance, if something came out of the Kremlin about how American soldiers were behaving, you would dismiss it. If it came from Washington or a national American newspaper or an American soldier who had been deceived, I'm not saying John Kerry was part of intentionally spreading disinformation, but Pachepa said, when he heard what John Kerry said, he said, my God, he's repeating our disinformation. Kerry was a young soldier who believed what he heard, from the world's foremost disinformation machine. He repeated it. That became much more persuasive than anything that would have come directly out of the Kremlin. And in our book, we trace the history of disinformation back from the Potemkin village. You may have heard of if you don't know the origin of the phrase, I mean, there really was this Russian prince or emperor who wanted to impress some visitors, particularly I think a visiting princess, and so they built a fake city like you see in a Hollywood movie set or something to make it look like there was a great amount of wealth when in fact there wasn't. But we see this in Soviet history. We go through some. There you see Lenin up on top. Now to the right, to your right on the podium, Trotsky and another person who was vying for power with Stalin. When the picture came through after Stalin's editing, those guys are gone. So you don't let them be next to Lenin, right? And Stalin, when he's in power, okay, first the company's there. Then I don't know if Stalin gave him an elbow and he's over the edge there or what, but you know, Stalin edited pictures like that. But Pachepa, I said there's good framing and bad framing. You can frame somebody as a great leader. You can frame somebody as a nice guy. And you can. It's just we're not used to that in our common lingo. But the term glasnost, which I think if you ask your average American, they would think glasnost would mean an opening and a warming and agreement. Glasnost actually means shining up of the leader's image, polishing the leader's image. So glasnost was what Pachepa had been doing for Ceausescu, polishing up his image, making him look like a good guy and trying to fool everybody else. Khrushchev famously had a secret speech, which he gave condemning Stalin. It was secret. It wasn't supposed to go out anywhere except copies were handed to CIA and Mossad and other groups immediately so that they could discover the secret speech. Indicating what? That Khrushchev said, you know, all this bad stuff that had been going on, that was Stalin. I'm a new guy, new era. Now, if he had just come out and said that, no one would, say, yeah, he promised, politicians promise. But if he said it secretly and we discovered it, well, wow, that's much more exciting. But this idea of blaming the last guy, polishing the current leader's image, blaming the last guy, you see, Brezhnev accuses Khrushchev of destroying communist unity. Gorbachev accuses Brezhnev. Every Russian Soviet leader came along, they've done that. The new leader has his image enhanced. Everything is blamed on the past leader.
Like Khrushchev, Bush.
The other thing Khrushchev did was he internationalized this information. It had been just from leaders kind of one to the other within Russia or the Soviet Union. He used it as a matter of international weaponry, really, by when he attacked Pius XII. He drew upon what happened after World War II. After World War II, we had areas such as Poland, Croatia, and Hungary, where you had strong religious leaders in religious nations who had been appreciated by the public, who when the communist leaders came in and took over, at first they kind of snuggled up to him and said, hey, we're just like your Christian leaders here. But of course...
All right, I got to cut this guy off. I thought this was actually the interview with this guy and Glenn Beck, which I heard yesterday, I believe. And it was just a little more engaging and a little more in focus. But at any rate, what this guy's trying to suggest is that what is going on behind the scenes is much vaster and connected than we probably have ever imagined. And that probably doesn't come as much as a surprise to you. But... we're about on break. You're listening to Daniel Gray. I'm the Trailer Park Prophet, broadcasting live on Blog Talk Radio from beautiful downtown Crestone, Colorado. This is Hump Day with the Prophet. Let's see. All right, let's see here. Let's move on. You know what? Maybe I do want to go to this article right now. That what's going on in the Ukraine is really profound. And I talked a lot about whether or not what was going on in the Ukraine was something that could be avoided. We talked a lot about it on Monday. And you know, I'm really kind of amazed how little I know about what goes on in that area of the world. And, you know, one thing I got to tell you, and that is, I was really shocked after we started talking again about the Ukraine that during the Bush administration, George W. Bush administration, that Georgia took back, or that the USSR or Russia or whatever they are, the Soviet Union took over Georgia, which is a state right next to the Ukraine. During the Bush administration, Russia was able to reconstitute a part of the former Soviet Republic, and they retook Georgia. And I got to look into this. And let's see, here's something interesting. Putin received strong words of support in 90-minute conversation with self. Oh, that could be funny. And it looks like by every source I've seen that President Putin is just walking all over President Obama. Now here's this article. And I got this from my friend Fred Bowder, who is sitting in the dentist chair right now as we speak. Let's hope everything turns out well for Fred. But I want to read this. This is so brilliant. This person that wrote this article is a genius. And his name is Boris Kogoskolitsky. He's from Moscow, and it's translated by Renfrey Clark. And he wrote this, or posted this, on February 3rd of this year. And he's talking about the crisis in the Ukraine. And I know you're really going to enjoy this, because it, within this piece, he goes into the history of that area of the world, the current crisis. And he also goes into the various allegiances and the complexity and the psychology that goes on in these type of events. And I say event because there's a lot of ways to describe what has been going on in the Ukraine over the last few months, last few years. And one thing that I find, here's something that you got to know, and I haven't seen any reporter talk about this, but this is key to understand what's going on in the Ukraine, and that is that during the Clinton administration, Ukraine agreed to give up their nuclear arsenal for an agreement that the United States and NATO would protect the Ukraine against the Soviet Union. All right, you need to understand that. So this is a big deal. And when you hear the president or any of the president's men or women out there saying, well, we're going to draw this or that red line and we're going to take this or that action, you have to understand that it is a foregone conclusion that the U.S. has already committed to take action. And it's interesting to note that the administration is not conveying the actual case here, that there were actual signed agreements, all right? And this'll sort of play into another angle I'm going to present to you after I work on this a little bit, because it's really ironic now that the president is in a situation in his narrative on the Ukrainian issue of saying of Putin that he has I'll just go into this. Yes, today President Obama was saying that President Putin has a different understanding of the laws. And the president was talking about this peace, not this peace agreement, but other peace agreements. And, well, I guess it would be the peace agreement I just talked about during the Clinton administration and a myriad of other agreements concerning the Ukraine and Russia. So the president's standing there saying that, oh, Putin doesn't understand. We have all these agreements. Everything's been agreed to and signed. And so Obama says that Putin must have a different understanding of the laws and agreements. And then Obama goes on to say that it sounds like President Putin has a different set of lawyers working a different set of interpretations of all of these international agreements. So here is the professor, the community organizer, preaching to President Putin, saying, no, 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 my experts know better than your experts, and we got ink on paper. And it just shows how feckless and weak this president is. And then John Kerry's running around out there saying that Putin, by moving his forces into Crimea, which is the northern part of the Ukraine, that somehow that is a 19th century technique, and reminding Putin in public that this is now the 21st century, you know, and sort of insinuating that President Putin is a knuckle dragger. And it's a way that you would want to insult your fellow blue bloods, you know what I mean, without putting on the dukes. You know, it's just like a upper crust gentleman's club, that you don't do certain things because we're sophisticated. And, you know, I just found it, it's just so profound. It's so absolutely positively profound. It's like our president and our Secretary of State John Kerry are in a total separate reality. And like the president yesterday said, he sent a strongly worded letter to President Putin. Well, Neville Chamberlain did the same thing, sent a strongly worded letter to Hitler after Hitler invaded Poland. The similarities are just, they're so alike. It's incredible, really, you know. I mean, like Shakespeare said, may you live in interesting times, and boy, we sure do. All right, so back to this article written by Boris Kagarlitsky. That's pretty good. The crisis that has risen in Ukraine involving a contest between the reactionary government that is becoming more authoritarian by the day, and a no less reactionary opposition, with the openly fascist tendencies has created something close to intellectual stupor on both sides of the border. The range of views extends from a readiness to take part in protests and demonstrations of any kind, regardless of their aims, purpose, ideology, and perspectives, to calls for supporting the existing authorities as a lesser evil. This is going to get better, trust me, and I'm going to read better. In Russia, these arguments have been superimposed on an inconclusive discussion focused on the lessons of the events of 2011 and 2012. Now, these are events that happened in Russia. And I got to confess to you, I totally forgot about this civil unrest in Russia. And what this article tries to do is compare the psychological elements of the rebellions in Russia in 2011 and 2012 and compare and contrast what's going on in the Ukraine today. And the reason all of this is important is that this could conceivably, this conflict in the Ukraine could conceivably develop into a world war for reasons that I gave you earlier. All right, the article goes on to say, though the effective results of the movement at that time are perfectly obvious, everything ended in total failure. The only questions are whether the left could have acted differently from the way it did and how the forces became redistributed on the basis of the outcome of the events. Against the backdrop of a general decline of the movement, by no means all of its participants finished up losing. Some, to the contrary, strengthened their positions. And he's talking about the elements of civil disobedience, the elements of a uprising. All right, that's what he's getting into. He's going to give us insight into the development and operation and life or death of a political event. All right, we'll call it that for now. But as we know, the Ukraine is not Russia. Contrary to the views of the liberal intelligentsia, the distinction is apparent not in any greater love of freedom or special passion on the part of the Western neighbors, but in the fact that the ruling class in the Ukraine simply has considerably fewer resources at its disposal. This determines this specific model of oligarchic democracy to be found in Kiev. The leading Ukrainian clans, unlike the Russian corporations, are unable to reach agreement and to divide the country up in such a way that everyone has enough of there are no pretexts for open conflict. In other words, there's not enough rich people. And which is kind of mind-boggling. In other words, the more rich people, the better. Because rich people are able to affect the outcome of whatever dispute or discussion that's going on. So in Russia, it was not Putin's authoritarian inclinations, but the objective ability of the ruling groups to satisfy all the big players, more or less, that allowed the relative stability of the decade from the 2000s, the same consideration underlay the sudden outburst of the crisis in 2011 when the ability of the authorities was placed in doubt. Meanwhile, the difference in the resources availability to the ruling classes of the two countries determines the social climate as well. The reason we Russians have tolerated our problems for longer is not because we are less passionate, but because our situation is objectively better. Nonetheless, the rapid exasperation of social crisis in 2014 threatens to end the state of affairs, even to the extent that the dancers change places. All right, now he's setting the stage for you. If political crisis and open social protests break out in Russia, everything that has happened on the squares of the Ukraine will look like child's play. And we're going to go into more of what's been going on the Freedom Square in the Ukraine. I think you're going to be a little surprised. I really was. Precisely for this reason, the question of the lessons of the Ukraine is extremely pertinent to the Russian left. The question is not about what our comrades over the Western border might or might not be able to do, but about the conclusions for the future that the left organizations of both countries manage to draw from what has occurred. In the larger framework, three major positions can be distinguished in the Ukrainian discussion with more or less distinct political organizations and currents standing behind them. Now, you just got a picture, you know, what's going on here. And this type of thing has happened, insurrection, let's call it, has happened in our society over and over and over again. So it's of good merit to understand sort of the dichotomy of the insurrection, of the revolution. I mean, the insurrection is sort of the catalyst to push the ball for a revolution. I mean, that's what's going on here. Now, as in Russia, the position of the liberal left consists of appealing to the movement to come together in the Ukrainian case on Independence Square. And despite the dominance there of the right wing, to join with the dominant nationalist and fascists is an ideological struggle for hegemony and the influence over the masses. This is the kind of declaration we hear from certain members of the left opposition whose articles and opinions are published enthusiastically on the Moscow site Open Left. And, of course, remember, there's all kinds of propaganda and information and reporting going on in the Ukraine right now. I mean, from everywhere. There's stuff underground, there's stuff in the, you know, just imagine that all of these various competing groups have their own propaganda arms, their own misinformation arms, all right? And one other point I wanted to make that was important out of this. Oh, okay, now, we were just introduced with the word hegemony, all right? And there's various other uses of this word, but in case you didn't know, hegemony is, in this instance, what it's saying is you have all these competing forces, and the winning force would be the one that had the hegemony force. In other words, they'd be able to push the political dialogue or push the political, how do I want to say this? Well, they'd be able to push their own political agenda, the hegemony. You know, you have the force of the people, the press, and enough of the important players that you have the force to basically mow over anybody else or disaffect somebody else or immobilize somebody else. But hegemony, it's a good word to know because it can be used in economics. It can be used in a lot of other contexts. All right, moving on. It says here, we see a logical continuation of the line pursued by the left liberals in Russia during the protests of 2011 and 2012, only taken to the level of the absurd. In Russia, the entire discussion along with the tactics pursued was defined by the fact that the left from the onset was an important element in the overall movement. Significant members of the demonstrators took their lead from the left, and the latter also enjoyed a definite authority and influence among the mass protesters. To a substantial degree, these authorities were let slip as a result of the positions taken by the leaders of the left front. But large numbers of the activists and organizations distanced themselves in good time from this position, getting the form of left forces to resolve a boycott the coordinating council of the opposition. The upshot was that as a result of the crisis of 2011, the ideological weight of the left in Russia's society increased. Even people who for 20 years had prevented or pretended we did not exist were obliged to notice us, but we shall scarcely be able to say the same about the outcome of the current events in Ukraine. And what he's described here is how the left, in this example in Russia in 2011 and 2012, were actually to exert enough pressure on their society to have the hegemony to decide, okay, you know, what's on the agenda. What are the problems? We're going to solve them this way. But it gives you an idea into, or it gives you sort of a lens or a tool to try and focus your organic computer on all of the moving parts of a event like this. And he goes on to say, he says, there's also another fundamental difference. In Russia, in 2012, we faced a struggle between leftists and liberals of hegemony over the protest under conditions in which the nationalists among the protesters were a relatively marginal force. On the independent square in Kiev, the left is forced to contend with nationalists and fascists. All right, remember yesterday and day before that the Russians were screaming that the opposition forces were actual fascist Nazis, and everyone in the lamestream media scoffed. Well, now this guy's telling us that there are fascists, there are nationalists. So we have some really hard right positions here that. And he's going to go on to describe their position, which I think is absolutely positively brilliant, because he gets into the psychology of a nationalist and or fascist. While it is possible to debate that liberals taking or talking to the ultra-right is pointless simply because rational discussion on the level of arguments and counter-arguments is quite impossible, the whole structure and culture of the ultra-right movement is founded on a completely different principle. Hegemony in these circles does not rest on theoretical or analytical constructs, but on force, to which another such force has to be counterposted. Now, this one paragraph, or it's one sentence at the end of this paragraph, is very insightful, and the message that this individual is trying to bestow upon us, and that is, he's making a veiled comment into the leadership style of President Obama. I know that's what he's doing here. And I'm going to read this sentence again to you. He says, the whole structure of the culture of the ultra-right movement is founded on a completely different principle. Hegemony in these circles does not rest on theoretical or analytical constructs, but on force, to which another such force has to be counterposed. In other words, these fascists are beyond consultation. You can't deal with these people intellectually. Quite frankly, they're crazy. All right? And the only way that you can stop these people is by force. That's it. You got to man up. You got to grow a set. You got to cast iron ovaries. You got to develop cast iron ovaries, whatever. But there are certain people in this world, and fascists are one of those people who are basically evil. In plain terms, cooperation with liberals, however doubtful from an ideological point of view, is a much lesser sin than collaboration with the ultra-right. Right, but the question is not one of abstract sins. If such a course opened up any prospects at all for the left, it would be possible to discuss even alliances that were quite strange from the theoretical point of view. Hence the term, politics makes strange bedfellows. The point, though, is that no such prospects exist. The left left on Independence Square in Kiev is invisible and audible, and few leftists, of course, were earlier beaten up and chased off, but at the moment the left is so insignificant in terms of its presence and influence that no one even bothers anymore to beat up its members. For the most part, the Ukraine left exists solely within its own imagination. This, of course, does not mean the left will never again materialize as a political force, but the first condition for this will be that it recognizes the actual state of affairs. I imagine they pretty much realize their state of affairs. Obviously, the people on Independence Square are not just benighted nationalists and followers of Stefan Bandera, but there is simply no niche there for the left to occupy. Technically, and in terms of the situation, no one apart from nationalists and the Banderviroists, the Banderviroists, by the way, were Nazi collaborators responsible for mass murder, can come out ahead. These are the only people who are finding the emerging possibilities suited to their ends. Meanwhile, the alternative to a victory for Independence Square is a dictatorship under Yanukovych. In this case, the position of democracy would be far worse than before the protest began, obviously. Finally, the prospect for a national reconciliation becomes more real with each day that passes. This would involve either a compromise between the Donetsky thieves and the pro-Ryong instigators of the LVOU, the most likely variant of these, a semi-disintegration of the Ukraine, not along east-west lines, but along according to the provinces. Not the worst possible variant, but also quite conceivable. If the boundaries of these are to be expanded, the limitations of the present situation must first of all be recognized. Further, we have to understand our real position. Instead of weighing one policy that is correct in the abstract against another policy variant, also incorrect in the abstract, we have to observe the strategy and tactics of the particular forces that are present while also considering the practical circumstances. Articles by any Ukrainian leftist fail to give any thought to this. Worse still is rehashing these discussions. Russian commentators uncritically repeat the same abstractions. It is impossible not to be reminded of Plato's famous quote, reflections of the reflections. And I think that his observation there is brilliant. And I found those same types of observations by George Orwell in his book Ode to Catalina, where during the Spanish Civil War you had all of these competing ideologies that were involved in the Spanish Civil War, and people would be changing sides. But what the author is talking about here is what Plato said, reflection of the reflection, and how the various groups are able to manipulate the press. And the press generally is two things, lazy and liberal. And so these groups are able to get their narrative out there by using the whatever media. And then the media repeats the propaganda, the narrative of whichever side, and states it as fact. And as things get said over and over and over again, then perception becomes reality. That's what he's talking about here. If organizational, ideological, and media bridgeheads have not been created earlier, there is no prospect of changing anything through attempts to involve ourselves in a process that is already underway without our participation. And here he's making a slide at Obama administration that this whole thing in the Ukraine has been boiling, and President Obama must have known, should have known, could have known, and they should have been laying the groundwork so that this type of thing didn't happen in the future. But of course, President Obama thinks the Cold War is over, and that Russia's no longer a geopolitical threat. So the early warning signs for the last 3 years that were being presented or happening in the Ukraine have been neglected. The bridgeheads, he keeps talking about the isn't it? He says Bridgehead or something. Yeah, he says, yeah, Bridgeheads. He goes on to say the left was able to play a certain independent role in the Russian protests of 2011 and 2012 because structures, leaders, activists, and organizations existed that were known at least in certain circles and that exercised authority beyond their own narrow domains. If similar bridgeheads have not been created in advance, then is pure naivety to self and self-deception to hope that the righteous might be outplayed by independent square, that a public fascinated by the struggle between the government and the opposition might be drawn over to the side of the left, and that leaders who have discredited themselves will be repulsed. Even in such a situation, however, passivity is no solution. Now, here's where he's really getting into Obama. It is highly significant that the site of the Borithaba, no, what it, see, it's the Bharata Party reached to the events unfolding around it by publishing an article by a fashionable Slovenian philosopher entitled On the False Sense of Urgency and Extolling the Ideological Withdrawal from a Unsatisfactory World. Again, On the False Sense of Urgency and Extolling the Ideological Withdrawal from Unsatisfactory World. In some situations, the only genuinely practical course is to fight the temptation to undertake action without delay and instead to sit and wait and engage in patent or patient critical analysis. But see, not doing something is doing something. All right, you know what? I've had enough of this story. I don't think it was really as good as I thought it was. When I read it, I was just completely overwhelmed. And you can read this article on my Facebook page, Daniel Gray, or the Trailer Park Prophet. If you'd like to, you can do that. And by the way, if you'd like to be, I should probably check my studio and see if I have any callers. I don't know why people aren't calling in. If you want to call in, you can do so. Dial 646-716-8506. Again, if you'd like to talk to the Trailer Park Prophet, you can dial 646-716-8506. You're listening to the Trailer Park Prophet. My name is Daniel Gray. I am your host du jour. We're broadcasting live on Blog Talk Radio from beautiful downtown Crestone, Colorado. This is Hump Day with the Prophet. And again, if you want to talk to the Prophet, you can do so by dialing 646-716-8506. Again, 646-716-8506. I forgot to make one point about President Obama scolding President Putin and how his lawyers or his people didn't understand the meaning of the language in these agreements. You know, I can't help but remind myself that he's accusing Putin of the same thing that Republicans are accusing Obama of by changing laws by decree, which is against our Constitution. Isn't that ironic? That's so ironic. And by the way, did you see this news? There's been another Obamacare extension. Evidently, people who have plans, healthcare plans right now that they're happy with, they're going to be able to keep those plans after the presidential election of 2016. Remember, they extended people's ability or right to keep their insurance for a year, and now they're going ahead and extending it another year. And the reason being is that they're polling. The Democrat Party, their polling is so terrible that they understand they got to somehow right this ship, this Obamacare ship, because it's headed right for a iceberg. You know, it's a disaster in the making, and they know it's going to hurt the Democrats in the poll. I mean, nobody can campaign out there defending Obamacare, and so if they keep extending various provisions of Obamacare, then people aren't going to know exactly how stinking rotten Obamacare is. I mean, this is desperate. The president is desperate right now. Man, I'm telling you, I bet you the president is sweating bullets. All right, another story here from Money Matt Press. IRS is sounding the alarm on renegade currency. The renegade currency is disrupting global economies, weakening the power of central banks, and transforming the financial dynasties of people around the world. What do you think about that? Bitcoin and all that? Oh, this is really unbelievable. Oh, it's not unbelievable. It's just rather remarkable and entertaining, so I wanted to share this story with you. It comes from The Blaze, and this just got posted. And The Blaze, in case you don't know, is the Glenn Beck Network, and he's got a story here posted on his website, The Blaze. And that's so funny. The Iranian military deputy chief of staff reportedly called President Barack Obama a low IQ president over Obama's repeated threat that a military strike remains an option for stopping Iran's nuclear program should a negotiation deal fail. I'm just happy to know that President Obama has made it clear there might be a military option. I thought maybe the president had taken that option off the table. Maybe he has in his own mind or personal discussions with his security team. God knows. At any rate, this Iranian general, Brigadier General Masoud Jazwiri, called Obama's comments on Iran in a recent interview, quote, the joke of the year. According to Iran's semi-official Fars news agency, can you imagine one of our generals doing something like that? He'd be fired instantly. So what that tells you is this guy has no fear of being fired for being so provocative. Saying the president has a low IQ. Now, you think someone in the lamestream media, if they were reporting on this story, would call this Iranian general a racist? Okay, this general goes on to say, he says, the low IQ U.S. president and his country's Secretary of State, John Kerry, speak of the effectiveness of the U.S. holds options on the table on Iran, while the phrase is mocked at and has become a joke among the Iranian nation, especially the children. Jazamari, the general, was quoted as saying, oh my God, Obama's statements about the number of the U.S. troops in the region and the extent of their influence are completely in expert remarks far from the reality, and these statements can be used as the joke of the year, he said, countering Obama's warning. Jazraeli said U.S. forces in the Persian Gulf are within reach of Iranian military. That's a threat there. If they the region will be turned into a hell for them, he vowed. And, you know, Iran always has that kind of bluster. In the interview published Sunday, Bloomberg columnist Jeffrey Goldberg asked Obama whether he believes the Iranian leadership takes his, quote, all options are on the table threat seriously. Obama, I know they take it seriously, Obama said. We have a high degree of confidence that when they look at 35,000 U.S. military personnel in the region that are engaged in constant training exercises under the direction of the president, who already has shown himself willing to take military action in the past, that they should take my statement seriously. Holy mackerel! I mean, the rhetoric is already escalating. And look how thin-skinned President Obama is. And see, here again, when you're the president, or this is Power 101. Whatever station in life you are in or somebody else, you never want to punch down. So if you're the principal, you don't want to punch down to the teacher. You only want to punch up. And here's President Obama having some general punch up at him. And what's Obama do? He punches back down. I mean, I'm telling you, this is a basic fundamental political rule that Obama, he can't get through his skin or his head. And that's because his skin is so thin. His mulatto, half black, half white skin is just too thin. All right, here. I may have just really screwed up. All right, what time we got? I did something dumb here. Hang on a second. I can figure this out. Oh, my God. What did I do here? What did I do? The old prophet sometimes makes some mistakes. Oh my God, what did I do? I just lost control of my program for the day. And I can't figure out how to get back to where I need to go. All right, everybody, just hang on tight. I'll be able to figure this out. On short order. Maybe. Oh, I've never seen all this before. Come on, baby. Help me out. You know, I gotta admit, sometimes I'm trying to keep my mind in the moment, and I'm trying to do whatever manipulations of my little tiny laptop computer and think about the next story. And of course, I was just thinking about how that letter I was reading didn't go like I planned. All right, so maybe I just need to F5 everything. All right, I gotta apologize.
Something better. When the last G8 summit took place in Dublin a year ago, President Putin and President Obama both went, and they both wanted to use the same gym at the same time.
Oh, listen to this.
They couldn't share. So it was, who got to use the gym? Well, President Obama got to use the gym. Putin, not to be outdone, said, fine, if you guys don't want me in the gym, I'm going to go dive in the icy lake in Dublin. I'm going to do the breaststroke across the lake, and I'm going to one-up you. So what happened? In all the newspapers in Dublin and all the newspapers in Great Britain and Ireland, there were pictures of Putin shirtless doing the breaststroke, muscles bulging. And then there was a companion picture of President Obama in the gym shirt shooting hoops.
I mean, it's embarrassing. I mean, the picture of him on that bicycle with that goofy hat on. Now, look, I'm going to be honest as a parent. Did I make my kids, when they were learning to ride a bike, wear that goofy helmet?
Yeah. For sure.
But when I grew up, all I did was ride my bike. I never wore a helmet. Ever. Not once. Not one time. And guess what? I had newspapers. And guess what? I went over the handlebars and I ran. You know, my friends pushed me into cars. We pushed each other into cars. We survived. I mean, it's embarrassing.
But it's a symbol of how the world perceives both presidents. Now, here's President Obama. What does he do? His first act when he gets in office is he cancels the missile shield in Poland and the Czech Republic. He sends the Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton, to Moscow to have a reset of relations, both of which the Russians sort of shrugged and said, sure, I'll take that, but, you know, what have you done for me lately? None of those acts were reciprocated, and in fact, just the opposite. No. They were met with strength.
All right, Todd, let me ask you this, because you know the mindset of Putin and the people of Russia. I mean, he's got everybody in his parliament supporting him 100%, this new annexation policy. I'm sure it's going to go well beyond Crimea. Well, by the time all things are said and done, I think he's got territorial ambitions far beyond that. But the reality is this president, I don't think he's come to the realization yet that this is forever and real and probably only the beginning. And he keeps talking about, well, they're going back to a 19th century mentality, a Cold War mentality. And I'm like, yeah, what part of that don't you get?
Well, John, I mean, Americans need to understand that this, the hit.
All right, that was Sean Hannity. Not really sure how we got on to Sean Hannity, but that was live. You're back to the Trailer Park Profit Show. Your host, Daniel Gray. Not so expertly executing his host duties. All right, anyways, move on. We got some other stuff to talk about. Did I do that story? Did I do this? Yeah, I did the CIA story. Here's another story I found really interesting. Now, this is just breaking. Now, the IDF, I'm not really sure who that is, but I think what they do is the IDF is responsible for monitoring all of the cargo ships and maybe airplanes at any given time. And they monitor all of this transportation of goods to ensure that nobody's smuggling arms. All right. That's what this IDF does. And it says here, a cargo of Iranian-made long-range missiles were captured en route to Sudan in daring open sea operation in which elite Navy unit raided the vessel. It's good to know that we have this kind of technology and organization and, you know, fast-action commandos. It says Israel seized a Iranian ship carrying advanced weapons destined for Gaza on Tuesday night and towed it to the Eilat port. The IDF said Wednesday, sorry, I don't know what IDF means, said Wednesday, elite troops from Israel's Navy, the Skayete 13 unit, boarded the ship in open waters on the maritime border of Sudan and Eritrea. Eritrea. Some 1,500 kilometers south of Israel. Yay. And it says here that the Kilo Sea Iranian vessel was sailing under a Panamanian flag, making its way to Sudan from Iran, carrying a cargo of advanced rockets capable of reaching distances up to 2,000 kilometers or kilometers. And here's a little video. It says the Iranian cargo ship carrying arms for Gaza left port 10 days ago and was on a track to dock in Sudan on Thursday. So here's another provocation. I mean, this is the third story we've reported on in the last year about a illegal arms shipment from Iran. I can't remember details right offhand, but all right, we better get on. I got video here, but we're going to move on. We got so many other stories to do before the end of the show. And I want to do one more station ID. My name is Daniel Gray. I'm the Trailer Park Prophet, and we're broadcasting live from beautiful downtown Crestone, Colorado on Blog Talk Radio. Oh, by the way, I got to do a pitch. I want to do a pitch here for my business, Trailer Park Prophet Love Connection. And it's a dating service. It's an international dating service. We're all over South America, Asia, India, China, Korea, all over the world, Russia, all over the Ukraine. And if you're thinking about, or you know somebody that might be thinking about wanting to do a little traveling, then get a hold of the Trailer Park Prophet Love Connection. Just go to your computer and Google Trailer Park Prophet Love Connection. And we've been in this business for over 20 years now. We're the most recommended, the most researched, the most scrutinized dating service on planet Earth. And we have over 20,000 women. We have offices all over the world. We've screened these women. We're certain that they're not scammers or con artists or prostitutes. These are great women. And if you want to go to a particular area where we have an office, we can help you. We can help you with your visa. We can help you with your plane flight. We can save you money. We can help you with your accommodations. We have these wonderful parties where you can meet these women. and it's safe and clean and beautiful and fun, and we have all kinds of events we can take you on, sightseeing or dining. So just remember, for you or your friend, the Trailer Park Prophet Love Connection. Oh boy, did you hear this? Michelle Obama plans a pricey trip to China on the taxpayer's dime. Evidently, Michelle Obama and her daughters and her mother plan a week-long solo visit to China this month that includes meeting with some Chinese officials. And you know the president loves it when Michelle's out of the White House or the two of them are separated. And I'll bet you anything there'll be stories that President Obama's past assistant and really close friend, a guy named Reggie Love, will be in the White House. And it's rumored that Reggie Love is President Obama's love concern, if not drug dealer. Reggie Love. But you know damn good and well that President Obama is happy Michelle and the kids are going to be out of the house. And this is kind of funny. It's a little posting here on my Facebook page. It has a picture of our Secretary of State, John Kerry. And it says, you just don't invade another country on phony pretexts in order to assert your interests. It's really 19th century behavior in the 21st century. And it has a picture of Gaddafi saying, I know, right. And that's exactly what we did to Gaddafi. We were leading from behind, but NATO forces invaded Libya to help oust Gaddafi. I mean, we use 19th century tactics too. It's just so amazing how these guys are so offended about breaking laws when in their own country they break laws all the time. And they're so indignant. You know, they act like they're caught so off guard. Oh my God, you mean Putin would actually send troops into the Ukraine? Wow, I mean, that's so unsophisticated. That's so barbaric. Well, remember one thing. They're not making more land. And I don't care how sophisticated you are. If you got the land, you got the power. I mean, you can have people call you a brute, but when you have the land, who cares who calls you a brute? A bunch of mealy-mouthed progressive socialist statists are all worked up sending you letters. I'd be laughing my ass off if I was Putin. Let's see. Here's kind of a quote, a flashback. Remember when Romney was trying to warn Obama about Russia, he flippantly said to Romney, this is Obama, the 80s called and they want their foreign policy back. I mean, that's junior high. This is the President of the United States saying the 80s called, they want their foreign policy back. That's like, nee, 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 nee. That's unbelievable. That's so immature. That's insanely immature. And this author goes on to say what he should have said was, hi, 80s, can I speak with Ronald Reagan? Because Romney is right, Russia is still a threat. But since the only thing on one page resume is community organizer and half-assed senator, he didn't know to say that. No, because he doesn't have much experience. And again, people are talking about how yesterday, or actually we talked about this on, maybe this was yesterday. I mean, I think we did talk about it on Monday. Russia, I can't remember, they did a test fire of one of their ICBMs, intercontinental ballistic missiles. And on that same day, here's President Obama in an elementary school standing on this little cutesy carpet, you know, with all of the whatever regalia of a kindergarten class. And here's our president in a kindergarten class. And here's Russia setting off ICBMs. I mean, the president is a skippy. He's a total skippy. He doesn't, I mean, if you're really serious about taking on or responding to the president of Russia, you don't do it from a kindergarten class. You do it from the bridge of a destroyer. You do it from the East Room, you know? I mean, you do it from a commanding place, or you go to like a military base and have all these army officials and soldiers behind you. I mean, this administration and all of the administration's men, they really have sort of a warped view of the world, and they don't have a eye for detail to put their president in a place that gives credence and weight and value to the severity and weight of the situation, this deal with Putin in the Ukraine. I mean, if you want to be tough, you don't do your speech from a kindergarten class. I mean, it's like these people are imbeciles. A kid in Columbus, Ohio, according to the Associated Press, a Central Ohio principal says she suspended a 10-year-old boy from school for 3 days for pretending his finger was a gun and pointing it at another. Let's see how much time we got left. Federal government will not enforce this important law. I wanted to look into this real quick. This is from the Heritage Foundation. This is a story they did yesterday. Says here, the Arizona Daily Star reports that less than half the people picked up by an Arizona Department of Public Safety officer and suspected to be in the country illegally are taken into custody by federal immigration officials or jailed, despite the best efforts of state and law enforcement officials to enforce U.S. immigration laws. The federal government is ultimately in charge, and it has little interest in enforcing the laws. Under President Obama, see? President Obama not enforcing laws. That's what they do. And now they're all worked up over Putin not following laws. I mean, it's so crazy. This guy is totally clueless. Under President Obama's federal immigration agencies are hamstrung, permitted to enforce only certain laws on certain people in certain conditions. I mean, this is not the way a Republican constitution country is supposed to work. It's supposed to be a country of laws, and everyone is under the purview of those laws, and all those laws should be enforced until they're changed. I mean, this is nothing but soft tyranny. When local police have faithfully performed their duties and identified potentially unlawful immigrants, Immigrations and Customs Enforcement, ICE, and the Customs and Border Protection officers are in many cases able to take custody of only the most dangerous criminal aliens. And if you remember, during the sequester, they even released some of those. They released 2,000 illegal aliens that were also criminals in this country because they said, oh, we don't have enough money. So they just turned loose all of these illegal alien felons into the society. Unbelievable. Even then, individuals referred from local police are 4 times as likely as others taken into Border Patrol custody to be released or plea their case before a judge. Data from the Center for Investigative Reporting shows that even so, when the federal government does pick up potentially unlawful individuals from local officials, it often just lets them go. And I know this from personal experience because I've talked to a lot of people who are involved in this area. And they say this happens over and over and over and over again. So this president has decided not to enforce our laws on immigration. And in my mind, that's call for treason. I mean, that's the principal job of our government, is numero uno, defend our borders. You can't be a country without borders. God, it's remedial education. All right, let's see. We don't have a lot of time left. This is a pretty big story, and it claims that between 1989 and 2014, about $1 billion flowed into campaign contributions. The incentive to use political connections for personal gain grows as the power of government grows. And this actually comes from Mercactus. If you want to look them up on the internet, you can do so. All you got to do is www.mercactus.org. But what they're showing here is where all the money came from in the last, let's see, I guess that would be 20 years. And it shows here that non-union sources gave 40, let me see, can I make that any bigger? Non-union sources gave $441 million. In campaign contributions, non-union sources, $441 million. And union sources gave a total of $552 million. So it's good to know, especially when you have to listen to all these more-offs when they talk about, what is that, Citizens for, what is that they're always talking about. At any rate, it's good to know that that unions give, I guess that's a substantial, they give substantially more money to campaigns than do non-union groups. And they list Microsoft, American Medical Association, AFL-CIO, American Bankers Association, Emily's List, Machinist and Aerospace Workers Union, Citigroup, United Parcel. I mean, they go through the big guys. In all of these, you'd recognize AT&T, ActBlue, whatever, Goldman Sachs, Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, United Auto, and on and on and on and on. But at any rate, in case you're in a cocktail conversation, you'll be able to tell them that unions give more money and have given more money over the last 10 years than do non-union sources. Just good to know. All right. Well, I don't know. Let's see. Do I have time to do one more story? No, I don't think so. Look, we got to get out of here. I'll be back on Friday for Local Friday. I got a really good show planned for you. I'm going to give you some personal insight into
60 seconds.
My experiences in local government. And I imagine we're going to have to give you an update on the Ukraine. I imagine there's going to be a hell of a lot happening between now and the next Trailer Park Profit Show. Local Friday. Thanks, everybody, for being here. We'll see you on Friday. Have any kind of day you want. ¶¶